The winter of 1963 was much milder than expected, with a complete lack of snowfall and blasts of sunlight puncturing the occasional cloud cover. Christmas Day itself had been rather disappointing, mainly because of a lack of decent presents and the fact that Mr. Dark had been absent, having fractured his ankle the previous day after tripping over the station master's cat. Christmas Day finished with a climatic battle of wits between Dave and Raymond during a fierce game of Monopoly, ending with Dave crushing the board in frustration as Raymond had somehow managed to acquire all of the properties. Soon, December 31st arrived, and the engine busied themselves preparing for their annual New Year's Eve party. So, let me get this right. We need to be here at 7:30, not 8. Correct. Why? Mr. Dark said he was able to attend tonight, and he has a surprise for us, apparently. A surprise? Ooh! Maybe it's some entertainment for us this evening. Maybe Brian's going to be rebuilt into a tender engine, to lug around all that extra weight he's gained. Ha 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 ha! Raymond, seriously, I will end you if you do not stop the fat jokes. He might let us go to that football match, Colin. Remember, Manchester City versus Tottenham Hotspur? He said he'd consider it. Calm down, fellas. We still need someone to collect the last shipment of alcohol from Gallon Junction this evening. Any volunteers? Oh, I'll do it, thanks, said Dave, though he privately thought to himself that he could easily empty a tanker or two at the junction without being noticed. That evening, Dave and Raymond stood together in the sheds at Gallon Junction, waiting to take their last trains of the day. Raymond had agreed to haul the final passenger service, whilst Dave was to take the beer tankers up to Mirkham afterwards. You know, this reminds me of something. What? Those times back in 1960, when me and you were just assigned to this shed together. I remember that one night we had that long discussion about girls and diesels. Oh yeah, I remember it well. Fun times, eh? Yeah, it was fun. Until we were rudely interrupted by... But Dave found he couldn't speak. He had just remembered who had interrupted them that night. It had been Sir Eustace Missenden, the pompous bully Pacific, who had bounced into the shed that evening and irritated the pair. Smiling to himself, Dave closed his eyes and began to reminisce about his former friend. He remembered that fateful evening when Eustace and Raymond had been called to doublehead and manage a special to Mirkham, cementing Eustace's and Raymond's friendly rivalry. Dave recalled that he had made a joke about them near Axley at some point, but couldn't remember what exactly it was. Then there was Sir Edgar Woolwinder's 61st birthday bash, where Eustace had come away from the night very drunk indeed, after abusing his birthday engine and being exceptionally rude to the others. And how could Dave forget the fact that Eustace had been very supportive of his relationship with Leanne, only to scorn him when the whole sorry scandal came out? Then there was all those times when Eustace had simply been there for him and the others, laughing with them and their jokes, occasionally becoming offended by the smallest things, but always having the best advice and sympathy for other engines, despite their backgrounds. Lost in these memories, Dave hardly noted Raymond leaving the shed to collect the coaches for his train, which had been dropped off by a small U-class mogul, which was obviously struggling for steam as he panted into the station. After a little while, Dave began to get impatient. It was already 7 o'clock, and there was no sign of the tankers. 10 minutes later, a Class 24 diesel fluttered into the station loop with the tankers, looking exhausted. Dave quickly hurried over. About time, jeez! Sorry, lost my way. Had to move out the way. Whatever, just give me the booze. I'm late enough as it is. Dave coupled up to the beer tankers and snorted away without a backward glance. Determined to make up for lost time, Dave hurried as fast as he could along the line, the tanker swaying ominously in his wake. Slow down, Dave! We're making good time! Don't push yourself! Dave ignored his driver and pounded over Woolchurch Viaduct, vaguely aware of a small, irritating pain building up in his firebox. He could hear his driver and fireman shouting in the cab, but didn't pay much attention to them as he thundered through Woolchurch. Then, the pain in his firebox reached an alarming level, and suddenly the pain climaxed, as a huge plume of steam erupted from his safety valves. Ah! Moments later, Dave had stopped. He felt his fire being dampened down and dropped underneath him as the pain in his firebox began to finally subside. What happened? Dave asked the driver, who was walking all around. Your fusible plugs have melted. We couldn't get any water from the tender to your boiler, and the water level dropped too much, all because you weren't concentrating. How is it my fault? If you hadn't been bouncing around, we might have been able to open your injectors and... Don't you dare blame me for your own idiocy! I'll be filing a lawsuit against you two! Oh, shut up, Cyril! Go back to Wolf Church and see if we can get a banker! Ugh, you'll have to be pushed up to Mirkroom now, Dave. Fantastic! 20 minutes later, the fireman returned, looking very pleased. Good news! Another engine turned up on the line just after we left the junction, and he has agreed to push us up to Mirkroom. He's here now, and you might even recognise him, Dave. Dave, who was still fuming at his crew, wasn't listening. Moments later, he felt himself moving slowly up the hill, as a vaguely familiar whistle echoed from behind the train. It was 7:55 by the time he arrived at Mirkroom. The engine behind him pushed him straight into Platform 3, before hauling the tankers away. Dave tried to get a glimpse of the engine, but he had rolled into the darkness before he had a chance. Dave was soon shunted into the sheds by Alan, and was put between Brian and Raymond, who both looked concerned about Dave as he continued to scowl. You're right, Dave. What's happened? My idiot crew! That's what happened! Those incompetent fools let me run dry, then tried to blame me! Well, I'll see about that! Shh! Mr. Dark had begun to speak. Well, welcome, engines. Now that we're all here safe and sound, he said, looking at Dave, I can finally reveal my surprise to you. The engine quietened down in anticipation. A few weeks ago, I was informed that a specific steam locomotive that may be of interest to me was about to be withdrawn from service and scrapped due to British Railway's current attitude towards steam traction. Luckily, I have managed to convince British Railways to sell me these locomotives at the final hour, and I am now the proud owner of my own express passenger locomotive. Now, some of you may recognise my new engine. Others will not have met the pleasure of meeting him before. But I can assure you, he will make quite an impact on you all. I trust you will all make him feel at home. Suddenly, a long drawn-out whistle erupted from the yard entrance, as a large steam locomotive backed down towards them. Mr. Dark spoke once more. So, I am very honoured to welcome back Sir Eustace Missenden! Everybody went silent as the engine backed into the shed. Eustace? Dave, how lovely it is to see you! But... Dave stuttered, staring at the Pacific. You don't look like... You can't be! Are you sure you're... What are you trying to say, Dave? Is it really you? Eustace laughed. Ha ha! Why, of course it is, my dear fellow. I promised I would return, and here I am. True, I look a little different now, but I am still the same bully Pacific that you remember. Dave's doubts began to vanish as Eustace began chatting happily with everyone else. So glad to see you're still here, Brian. Still as heavy as ever. Watch it! And Raymond too. How splendid. Owen, Ryan. Managed to haul any expresses in my absence. I jest. Do I spot Fear and Otter over there? Oh dear, too much to drink already. Tut tut. And who might you three be? He asked the new engines. Well, I'm Colin. This is Edward, better known as Eddie. Hello. And that is Alan, he finished, indicating the blue shunter. Nice to meet you, useless. It's Eustace! As the evening went on, Eustace continued to beam around at the oven, laughing and joking with them, and genuinely drinking way too much beer. Eventually, he got around to telling the engines about the circumstances of his rebuild. So, obviously, there was nothing we could do. The rails were too slippery and my regulator was jammed wide open. My wheels just spun and spun until my valve gear ripped itself apart and I finally stopped. When they removed me from Parkstone Bank, I saw that I had worn grooves in the track. How undignified! Oh, instead of sending me for scrap, though, those fine fellows at British Railways arranged for me to be rebuilt into this new shape, which, I must admit, I'm much happier with. Midnight approached, and the sleepy conversations that had punctured the air subsided as everyone prepared to count down the seconds until the new year. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1! Happy New Year! The engines honked, whistled and cheered loudly, letting off steam and clagging excitedly as the year of 1964 officially began.